Good afternoon, here. So we'll start with the session in continuation with the instruction set. So to have the recap on what we have discussed in the previous class, we have discussed about the data transfer instructions related to stack memory, that is push and pop, and then we have seen a couple of examples. Further, we had the introduction to the arithmetic instructions such as add and add c. So we have seen that add as well as add c with the carry supports in all the data types, and the prerequisite is the destination and accumulated itself, not other source. So we'll further take it ahead to the next sections of the instruction. Okay, so the next instruction we have is increment. So the mnemonic that is used is INC. So it is specified by only one operand. The original value, if it is FF on incrementing, it goes back to a value of 0. That means it rolls over. Similarly, if at all the if it is 16-bit data and if it is FFF on further incrementing, it again rolls over to 000. So no flags are again affected by this particular instruction. So when this instruction is to be used, now if you look at the increment instruction, it can either be used with the register or it can be used with a memory, direct as well as indirect. Nevertheless, the increment instruction, when it can be used with a direct address, you can also specify the port address of P0, P1, P2 as well as P3. In that case, the modification, whatever happens, is at the output port. So the value that will be used is the port data, which is being read from the output data latch, but it is not the pin data. So as we know, the ports have got the pin as well as the latch associated. So when you increment the content, right, it would be with respect to the data latch. So these are the instructions, addressing modes that are being supported with increment. So the first one, we have it as increment A. So let us take an example. When we say INC A, before the instruction, if the content of accumulator A is 99, then on using this particular instruction, that is 99H, on using this instruction, the content of accumulator will be 9AH. So as discussed in the initial, if at all the content of the accumulator say is FF, right, on further incrementing, it will be equal to 00. The next we have is increment RN, where it will increment the content of the register RN, where N can take a value from 0 to 7. So again, if you say increment R2, the content of the register R2 before the execution of the instruction, if it is say as 27H, on executing this instruction, it would be 28H. So it means that the content of the accumulator or the register would simply get incremented by a value of 1. It holds it true when you talk about the direct address also. You specify the address, it gets incremented, and even in case of the indirect. In indirect, we know that R0 would be pointed to a memory location, say something as 79H, and when you say INC at the rate R0, then this value is incremented and we get it as 7AH. So what is the need of using these increment instructions? So this increment instruction can be used whenever you have a series of memory that can be read, or increment can also be used in case of the example such as you want to search a data from a large data on incrementing. So that is how you can use it. So the increment A, increment RN, and increment direct as well as increment at the rate RI, they all are associated with the 8-bit. Nevertheless,
we can also use this instruction increment with the DPTR. So let us look this bit in the detail.
As we know that DPTR resistor consists internally of two resistors,
that is DPH and DPL. This contains the lower byte and DPH contains the higher byte.
So before executing the instruction, if DPTR say contains the value 2678H, on using the instruction increment DPTR,
this becomes plus 1. So the result will be 2679.
So the most significant byte, that is in the DPH, would still be 26, while only the value in the lower, that is DPL, would be incremented by 1. It's not both of them, that is the higher byte as well as lower byte will not get incremented.
But before the execution of the instruction, if you see that the content of DPTR is say as FFH,
26FFH.
So when we add 1 to this, increment by 1, so this will be 0, this will be 0, carry taken, then it will be 27.
So we see that only when the lower byte of the DPTR resistor, that is in the DPL resistor, it is FF, when you further increment, then would be the increment that happens in the DPH resistor. Otherwise, it always happens into the DPL resistor itself. This is one thing that we need to remember.
And all other instructions of INT with the addressing mode of
resistor as well as direct and indirect will be 1 byte. While the instruction INC DPTR would require 2 bytes. The next instruction we have is a decrement, right? So it is just the reverse of the operation that happens in case of the increment. When you talk about the decrement,
it decrements the content by a value of 1.
So as we know, when you
have the maximum value of FF, on incrementing it becomes 0,0. Similarly, when you have the minimum value to be 0,0 and when you decrement, it underflows to a value of FFH.
Fine. And this holds true even for a 16-bit.
So when you have a 16-bit data, if the initial data is 0,0, when you further decrement, it underflows with a value of FFH.
Right. So again, as in case of the increment, this decrement instruction will also decrement the content of the output latch of the port when the port address is being used, not the pin configurations. So the instructions that are supported with the decrement, the addressing modes, it is decrement A, RM, direct and at the rate RI.
When you say decrement A, before the instruction, if the content of accumulator say is 49H and on using the instruction, it decrements by a value of 1 and the result would be 48 stored into the accumulator. Similarly, when you say decrement RA, maybe this is the resistor R6 being used, and if before the execution of the instruction, the content of the resistor R6 say is 4AH, on decrementing the value will be 49H.
The next instruction we have is again decrement direct. So direct is the address that is being specified whose value gets decremented by 1. Then we also have decrement at the rate RI. Again, RI is nothing but R0 or it can be R1 pointing to a memory location, and it gets, because that value gets decremented by 1.
As rightly said, again with respect to DPTR, which is a 16-bit resistor, when you say decrement DPTR, before the instruction, if the content of DPTR is say something as 27FF, or before that let us assume it as 5F5H. On decrementing, the value will be 27F4, where F4 would be in the DPH resistor and 27 would be in the DPH resistor. But if at all the content of DPTR before the execution of the instruction is
27FFH,
on decrementing, it will be a value of, when you do it as minus 1, what do we get? We get it as 26, no. When you subtract this 1, it will be E, and then this will be F, 7 and 2. But if you have it as 2600, and then you say minus 1, then it will be 25FF.
Right? So this is how you can use this instruction DPTR. Again, decrement DPTR will be occupying 2 bytes of the memory space, while all others, decrement A, decrement RN, decrement direct, all would require 1 byte of the memory space. So let us take an example. Though we discussed ADC instruction yesterday, but this was required for us to go ahead with the programming of 2 16-bit numbers. So here we have the example, write an 8051 assembly program to add 2 16-bit numbers. Assume the first 16-bit number is in the resistor R3 and R2, while the second 16-bit number is in the resistor R1 and R0. Possibly this is one of the lab exercise that we have for the curriculum. So here, there are different ways in which the data can be stored. In this example, I have said that it is stored in the resistor R2 and R3, as well as R0 and R1.
So let us see how do we go about in understanding this problem statement and working on it. When we say R3 and R4, R1 and R0, it means of the total 16 bits, the lower 8 bit data and the upper 8 bit data. That is, the lower byte of the first two numbers is held in the resistor R2 and R0, while the upper byte is held in the resistor R3 and R1. So how do you go about it? As we know, we need first add the lower byte and then we'll be adding the higher byte.
So if at all there is a carry that is being generated, then that carry has to be considered in the next byte of the addition.
So pretty straightforward example. We assume that already the content, right, is in the resistors specified R3, R2, R1 and R0. So we will say move A, R3. So the first data is being bought into the accumulator, and then we will say add. We will say add A, comma, the next data which is already, the lower is in R2, right? So it will be R2, and then it will be R0 that will be done. So the result is available in the accumulator. We can say move R4, comma A. So the addition of R2 and R0 is done, and it is being stored in the resistor, that is R4.
Right.
Now we need to perform the addition of R3 and R1, the higher byte. We will move the content of R3 in accumulator. Now there is every possibility that a carry is being generated. So instead of using only add, we will use add C A, R1. So the addition of these two numbers along with the carry bit would be added, and let us store that data in the resistor R5. It gets stored in the resistor R5. Now, coming back to the different way in which the program can be rewritten. Instead of defining them in the registers, let me assume that the data is stored in a memory location. Right? It is stored in a memory location. So we can have, let us take that this is address 00, 01, 02, and 03. So if at all the data, right, lower byte is stored into the lower address and the higher byte is stored into the higher address. So here we have whatever we said RK and so on, maybe these two together will be the first byte and these two would be the second byte of the data. So according to this, what we need to do is we need to add the content of memory location 00 with the content of memory location 02. And then we have to add these two together. Fine, if I say the lower byte here and the upper byte here. There are ways that I said, maybe I will define as variable num1 of the type word. Defined word is another directive. In the previous class, we have looked into defined byte, wherein it allocates one byte of the memory space. Here what we have done is, we have defined it to be as the word, wherein it is allocating two bytes of the memory space. So if you say DB and I give the value is 00,00, and next we will write num2 again say DB 00,00. Right. So I can use two pointers. One register R0 to point to the variable num1, and we can use the register R1 to point to the variable that is num2. And then we can use an indirect way of doing it and going ahead with it. Otherwise, what would be the other option? I'm just giving you the hint on the different ways in which the data can be stored, right, into the memory. Or we can have a table which is of the type DB, and I will allocate four memory space. Wherein I will say the first two numbers are associated with the first 16 bit and the next two are associated with the second 16 bit. Of the byte, I will also assume that the first 8 bit is the lower byte and the next 8 bit is the and the internal RAM memory 8-bit address itself. Then we will say move a, at the rate R0. So the first byte is copied into the accumulator. Then we will increment the register R0. So when R0 was there, it was pointing here. Now when you increment, it will point to this address. Similarly, we will say move Okay, let me store it into the temporary register. Let us put it into the temporary register. We'll say move R2 comma A. I need to load it. Then we'll say move A comma at the rate R1. So this number, right, will be bought into the accumulator. So the first number of R0 is brought into R2. This A is bought here. Then we can say add A comma R2. So if I say these two are the lower bytes of the data, they would be added. And then we will say move say R4 comma A. So the first addition data would be available into the register R4. Remember, R0 and R1 is still pointing to the first addresses of the data lower byte. Next, what we do is we will increment both the pointers. We say increment R0 and increment R1. So the R0 pointer now goes to the second data as well as R1 pointer goes to the second data. I can reuse the accumulator now. We'll say move A comma at the rate R0. So the second byte is brought into the accumulator and store it again into the register R2, because already the addition is being performed. So you can reuse that particular register. And then we'll say move A comma at the rate R1. So the higher byte of the second number is being bought, and then now here we will say add C A comma at the rate, sorry, A comma R2. Data is already available. We can write it as A comma R2. So the data is available into the accumulator, the second byte of the higher byte of the data, and that can be moved into the register R5. So you see that in this way of writing, R4 and R5 will contain the lower and the higher byte of the result, and if carry is being generated, it would be available into the carry bit. Fine. So this is how you can use and write the program. Now here we have put the result in the register R4 and R5. Nevertheless, I can have a pointer and or another variable as a result being defined of the type byte. Reuse the register, because we have already done with the addition. You can reuse the register R0 to point to memory location, and finally it can also be put into the memory location. Now what is the advantage of using the memory, right, as a data? So during the runtime you can modify the content, right, or you can give different test cases to your program and you can do it. But the moment you store it in a register and it becomes a part of your program, every time what you need, you have to go back, exit from the debug mode, I mean change the values, save it, build it, enter into the debug mode and check it. So it would always be better if you have the data put onto the memory, wherein you can do it at the runtime. Okay. So this is what actually the logic that we have already discussed I have put up. Read the lower byte of the data stored in the register, one operand in the accumulator and other to be into the register R0. Perform the addition, store the result. I have not written all the intermediate steps that we have already written in the program here. Then read the higher byte of the data stored in the register as one of the operand, put it in the accumulator, and the other can be the register R1. Perform the addition now, it is with the carry. So the first byte it would be without, but the higher byte it has to be done, and then you can store the result. Okay. The next instruction we will look upon is the instruction DA. DA stands for decimal adjust after addition. So what is the importance of this instruction? The importance of this instruction is, when you compare or the add and add C instruction
would be used for a hexadecimal additions. But when you perform BCD addition, the result should also be a BCD. For example, when you add two numbers which are in hexa, say for example, I add 45H and add 55H. So normally when I take this to be as a BCD number, what is the result that I expect? 5 plus 5 is 10 and this is 10. So the result will be at 100. Okay, because of BCD addition, any number between 0 to 9. But since the system that we are working is all with hexadecimal, so what is the result that we will obtain here is after addition, when we add 45H with 55H, as you know, 5 plus 5, 10, in hexa it is A, and then 9. This is what is the result that we get. Fine. So, die is an instruction or decimal adjust after addition with accumulator. This instruction works only with the accumulator. So, this is an instruction which helps us in adjusting this, non-BCD number into a BCD number. So, how it works internally is, it checks for two conditions. That is, it checks whether the number is, it does nibble by nibble, and BCD, obviously it's a 8 bit which is consists of lower nibble as well as the high. So it checks the data nibble by nibble, and it checks for two conditions. What are those conditions? The first condition, it checks whether the number is between 9 A to F. If at all the number is between A to F, then it adjusts by adding a value of 6. That is one condition for the lower nibble, or it checks for the auxiliary carry. So even when the auxiliary carry is being generated, then also it will add a value of 6. Right. Now similarly, when we talk about the higher nibble, it checks for the condition whether the result that is being obtained on the addition of two higher nibbles, whether it is between A to F. If so, 6 is being added. Else, it checks whether a carry is being generated. If a carry is being generated, then also it will add 6. So let us look into the example over here. The previous same example, 45H plus 55H. So on adding this, we get it as A and 9H. Right. So now A obviously is not a valid BCD number. So to this, we add a value of 6. So A plus 6 after A, B, C, D, E, F, and then it is 10. Add this to, you get it as 10, and it's the same that we obtain when we do a BCD addition of 45 plus 55. This is one example. Let us take another example. Say for example, it is 98 plus 29, or rather let me 22 will still give me a value of A. Okay, let me take it as 28.
8 plus 8 is 16, but when it comes to hexadecimal, it is 10. So you see that the auxiliary carry will be generated. So the first condition of the number between A to F fails because the result we have got is 0. So what is the condition that it checks? It checks whether the auxiliary carry is being generated. Since the auxiliary carry is being generated, then it adds 6 to this. So you get the 6. What about the addition of this? 9 plus 1 is A, B, C. So it is C6. Again, now C. C is not a valid BCD number. So what it has to do? It has to add 6 and 0. 6. So after C, it is D, E, F, 10, 11, and 12. So is it not when you add 98 and 28, the addition 6, we get it as 126. Fine. So this is how the DA instruction would help us in converting the non-BCD number into a BCD number. As an exercise, I think you can try to working out on implementing the DA instruction itself with this method using the basic instructions that we have discussed. Then you would know that the DA instruction does internally so many operations and it internally uses lot many instructions to do the job. So in this example, what I have taken now listed over there, it's a very simple or which we have already discussed. If you have 99 plus 99, the answer is again 198. So this will not be it will not be obtained when you perform. So you have to follow the same method. What you'll be getting would be in a hexadecimal. Use the same method, it does, and it gets converted into the required ones. Okay, so most important here is the DA instruction is to be used after add or add C. Now, why did we say that it is a rule? Because the intent of using a DA instruction is after performing the addition of two BCD numbers, if at all the result is a non-BCD number, then DA instruction would help us to convert. But if you randomly use the DA instruction anyway, it simply reads whatever is the content of the accumulator and it converts into the required BCD if it is not so. So let us look into the example how it is to be done.
Write an 8051 assembly code to add two BCD numbers. So, read the first number in the accumulator, right? And the second number can be in any resistor put into. Add the numbers and convert to valid BCD. So, how would be the instruction? Let me assume that the data is say in the resistor R4 and R5. You have to perform the addition of these two BCD numbers. We will say move A comma R4. So, the first number added to in the previous first example at 45H, added with 55H. Okay. So, the content of accumulator after executing would be having the value of 45. And then we will say add A comma R5. This is in the register R5. So when you perform the addition, what will be available in the accumulator after this? The result A, 9A would be available in the accumulator. Now you need to convert. We will use the instruction DAA. So what this instruction does, whatever is that 9A would be converted into 100. That, but the most significant digit 1 would be shown as the carry. So you can observe that after executing this instruction, C would be equal to 1, because when you add this to this A, then B, C, D, E, F and 1, 0, 1, the addition of these two in again would be A. So this you add 6 to it, so you get 1, 0, 0. So 1, I mean this 1, right, would be reflected as the carry being generated, and in the accumulator you will have the value to be as 00. So when you read the complete data, you consider the carry as a part of the result along with the accumulator. So this can be worked out even for a 16-bit. If it is for a 16-bit, you take the lower 8-bit of the data, perform the addition, use DA, and go ahead with it. For the higher byte of the data, instead of using add, I can use add C. So that whatever carry is being generated after addition of the lower byte, it gets into consideration for the higher byte, and then after that you again use DA instruction. So this is an example which helps us to understand the usage of the DA instruction. So the next instruction we'll move on to is the subtraction. So in case of the 8051, we do not have two separate instructions for subtraction alone and subtraction with borrow considering. Like for example, add, we have got two separate instructions. That is add and add with the carry. But when it comes to subtraction, it is always subtract with borrow. So what does that mean? If at all you do not want to consider the borrow in the subtraction, then you simply need to clear the carry flag. Then operation wise, as we have discussed the concept of the signed numbers, unsigned numbers, it again holds true when we talk about subtraction. The number system, whatever we discussed for addition, will hold true. But when subtraction is being formed, what this does is, if you look at the ALU, you do not have a subtractor circuitry altogether, separately. But if you remember in logic design, we have studied a adder subtractor circuitry, right? Wherein you give the carry input 1 and then you have the XOR arrangement which performs 1's complement. Take the carry into consideration, it becomes 2's complement. Which means that when you want to subtract two numbers, say 20 and 16, and then you So there is no direct subtraction option. What it does, it performs the 2's complement of the second number, minuend, right? And then it performs the addition with the first one. So the same thing holds true when you look into the instruction of the sub B. That is, the second number from which it has to be subtracted, the number which has to be subtracted, the minuend, its 2's complement would be performed internally and it would be added with the first number, and the result would be reflected again onto the carry flag, auxiliary or the overflow flag. So the different support of the modes, addressing modes, you can, as it is again the first operand, or rather one of the operand should be an accumulator, which is the destination. right? The source can either be an immediate data, or it can be into a resistor, or from the memory. And when we say it is from the memory, obviously it is either directly, the address is directly specified, or the address is indirectly specified. So here we have the listing of the different instructions that are being supported with the sub B. So let us take one example which holds true for the remaining type of the modes. If we say sub B A comma hash 40H, right? And before this instruction, maybe we have written move A comma hash 55H. So basically what this instruction does, it's going to subtract 55 minus 40 along with the carry. Okay, so if I do not want the carry to be considered, what you need to do is you need to use the instruction CLRC. So this is a new instruction that we have got introduced. Carry, clear the carry flag. As you know, in the program status register, program status word register, there is a carry bit, right, wherein you can set or you can clear the carry. So you need to write this instruction first, CLRC. So what this does, whatever is the content of the carry would be cleared off, right? Then this will have no effect, simply it would be minus 0. So in effect, it would be the subtraction of 65 minus 40. So what it does, it performs the full complement of this 40 and then it performs the addition of this. So how do you obtain the 2's complement of 40? Obviously, you have to represent this in the form of the binary. And a simplest method is you keep on moving towards 0001, and once you find, then you perform the 1's complement. This gives you the 2's complement of the 40. And to this, what we will do, that 65 represented as 0110101. So you perform the addition now, 1010101, right? So now this carry that is being generated would be discarded. So what you get the effect, the result would be as 2 and 5 in hexa. And if you do this a normal subtraction, what you get the result to be as 25H. Fine. So this is how the sub instruction operates, or it works internally, taking 2's complement of the second number. Fine. So we'll conclude the session for the day. So we just began with the continuation of the previous class, wherein we discussed further upon the arithmetic type of instructions, that is with the carry or a normal addition with different addressing modes. Then in this particular session, we introduced 2 new instructions, that is increment and decrement. And we have also seen how you can use those instructions, increment or decrement, through an example of performing the addition of 2 16-bit numbers with the carry. Maybe the data is stored in the memory, so you can have the pointer and use increment as such with the resistors. And then we studied the most important instruction, that is DA, which helps in converting a non-BCD number into BCD number. And we have also discussed, or we have rather learned, how internally this DA instruction converts a non-BCD number, rather a hexa number, into a valid BCD number through examples. And we have written a small code where how the DA instruction can be used to convert into add 2 BCD numbers. And then further we moved on to the next instruction, that is a subtraction. And we saw that the subtraction comes always with the borrow. That means we do not have subtraction instruction alone, but it is with the borrow. So we saw that if at all you do not want the borrow bit to be considered, you don't have a different borrow flag in the PSW, it's the carry flag itself being used as a borrow flag in case of a subtraction. So if you do not want that to be as a part of a subtraction, then simply we can use clear carry instruction which clears the contents of the carry flag, and then you perform the subtraction. And we also saw that the subtraction is done using 2's complement of the minuend and then added, that comes the result. So we have taken an example and we have also proved or understood that yes, internally the sub-B instruction does in this method of performing 2's complement and adding and getting the result on. So with this, we wind up with the today's sessions, and in the next session, we'll take further ahead with the different instructions with the. Thank you for any queries, as you already have my email ID put across onto the first slide itself, or you can contact me, or you can very well put it onto the chat. Then maybe I will be able to address those queries during the session, or it can be into the next session. Thank you. Thank you, one and all.